Well, good morning. My name is Bill Garvelink. I'm a senior advisor here at the CSIS for the Project on U.S. Leadership and Development. And on behalf of the Institute for Economics and Peace and CSIS, I'd like to welcome you all here this morning. I think it will be a very interesting session. It is our pleasure to host the American release of the sixth edition of the Global Peace Index and the inaugural edition of the Positive Peace Index. This is a very interesting topic for CSIS. We're very much interested in fragile states and conflict-affected states. One of our programs, which is Crisis, Conflict, and Cooperation, we call it C3 around here, is doing research on strategic options and tools to be used in fragile states, and we have a working group that's focused on the private sector and how it can contribute to the stabilization of fragile states. So this topic is very important to us, and one of the issues that no one has really come to grips with yet is the relationship between economics and fragility, and with that conflict. So this is an area that is of great interest to us, and the Institute for Economics and Peace is one of the few institutions that looks at this in a systematic way. So the Global Index, the Global Peace Index looks at 158 countries and uses 23 indicators to do that, and that will be discussed during the course of the day. And as I understand it, it's a little more peaceful this year than last year, though there are a few caveats to that, which I'm sure will be discussed today. I would like to introduce the panel and then introduce the first speaker. To my left is Michael Schenck. He directs policy and operations of the U.S. Institute for Economics and Peace. He is on the board of directors of the National Peace Academy, and in his spare time, he's finishing his Ph.D. at George Mason University. He's also worked on Capitol Hill and for the United Nations and for NGOs. Right?
Yes, apparently.
Yeah. I thought I read that. I'm not making this up. And Lawrence Wilkinson, who's down second from the left, is Distinguished Adjunct Professor of Government and Politics at William and Mary College. He was the Chief of Staff for Secretary Colin Powell and held several other jobs in the State Department, and before that had a more than 30-year career in the U.S. Army. Emily Cadet is the foreign policy writer for the Congressional Quarterly for the politics website based in Washington, and she's covering House and Senate politics, gubernatorial politics, and I suspect a little busy right now. It's kind of a hot item. And one of our speakers, Josh Rogan, was unable to join us today and will not be part of the panel. So that's the panel, and it should be a very interesting discussion. Now it's my pleasure to introduce Dr. Anne Marie Slaughter. She is the Bert G. Kierstetter Professor for Politics and International Affairs at Princeton University. From 2009 to 2011, she was the Director of Policy Planning at State and the first woman to hold that position. And prior to that, she was the Dean of the Woodrow Wilson School of Public Service and International Affairs, and I believe the first woman to hold that position as well. And she has written extensively, which I assume you all know, and is a frequent participant and contributor to various media activities around town here and on the East Coast. And she is also, with CSIS, a member of the Executive Council on Development. And with that, please welcome Dr. Anne Marie Slaughter.
Thank you. It's always a pleasure to be back and to be at CSIS, and I see some old friends in the audience, and I also see lots of new faces, which in itself, by which I mean younger faces at my age, but which I think is itself a very encouraging sign for this Global Peace Index. And I have to say, I was aware of the Global Peace Index, but this time I've had a chance to really read through it, and particularly to focus on the positive peace index. And I thought I would make a number of general comments and then raise two questions that perhaps can be taken up in the panel. And I will just say in advance, I have to leave at 9:30 for the Council on Development, but so if I have to depart, do not take that in any way as a reflection on the proceedings. So the first thing to say, I think, about the Global Peace Index is the adage, you can't manage what you don't measure, which has probably been overused in various ways. We're all obsessed with metrics in many different parts of our lives. Certainly government is very focused on metrics and development is focused on metrics. So it may be overused, but still, creating an index is important as a foreign policy tool. Before we had Transparency International and the Corruption Index, it was much harder to actually focus countries and companies on corruption. Very important, basic move. Let's map what's out there. Let's create criteria. Let's measure it. So that's the one I think many of us think about first with respect to Transparency International. But the human rights reports of the State Department were doing the same thing. Controversial always, as having worked at State for 2 years, it was always something we knew when we were going to roll out those reports, there was going to be a lot of opposition. But that's what we effectively said, starting with President Carter and making human rights a core part of our foreign policy. It was one thing to declare it. It was another to actually do it systematically with criteria measuring different levels of human rights protection. And then more recently on the economic side, competitiveness indexes and health indices. So the idea that there is a global peace index, to me, is very important, that it says this is not just something that we can assess qualitatively and subjectively. This is something that can be measured and that has many different criteria. That makes it easier as a foreign policy practitioner then to figure out how you use this as a tool in terms of engaging governments, but also, of course, in connecting international organizations, corporations, NGOs, universities to the idea of measuring peace. So that's the first point. Second, and closely related, is precisely what that then means about how we define peace. And as you know, the Global Peace Index defines peace not just as the absence of war, interstate or domestic war, which is still, I think if I ask my teenagers what's peace, they would say there's no war. This, of course, goes well beyond just the absence of war. It goes beyond just the absence of conflict. So we can think of many countries in which there's conflict that might not amount to the definition of a civil war. Just think every day, the question is Syria, does Syria have a civil war or not, right? Syria is on the brink of civil war. No, people respond, Syria already has a civil war. Nobody would deny there is an intense military conflict going on. But this definition of peace goes beyond the absence of conflict. And indeed, it goes beyond even the absence of instability, because one of the measures is political stability as one of the components of peace. So the definition is the absence of violence or the fear of violence. And that seems to me to be very important in terms of thinking about what I think about a great deal in foreign policy, what Secretary Clinton has done a great deal to institutionalize at the State Department, which is to think about not just absence of interstate violence, but absence of violence that affects how human beings live their lives. And that could be violence from drug cartels, that could be violence from insurgents, that could be violence simply from gangs, that could be violence against women in the home. And one of the questions I have, which I'll just signal now, which we've actually already had an interesting conversation about, is how you measure violence against women as part of this index. And there are a number of indices that pick that up, even though it's not directly there. But that idea that absence of violence or fear of violence is what peace means collapses interstate security and human security. It puts them in the same overall spectrum. That, to me, is one of the most important developments in foreign policy, certainly in my lifetime, has been to move from caring about just the security of states to the security of the individuals within them. So the definition there of peace in the Global Peace Index is very important. There's some interesting dimensions, of course, the degree of militarization. Once you saw that, you knew the U.S. was going to go way down, as well as the levels of crime. I think that's actually a very important and interesting indicator. My second question there, though, is why contributions to peacekeeping is included, because I actually think, although for some countries, contributions to peacekeepers may be a reflection of the size of their army. For others, it's actually about a deep commitment to peace. I think of Canada, I think of a number of the Scandinavian countries. So those are my two questions for the compilers of the index. But the third point is this idea of the positive peace index, which really is we're seeing the first time here. And again, on the idea that we are thinking about international security and human security, positive peace goes much farther. It's not just the absence of violence or fear of violence. It's the set of attitudes, institutions, and structures which, when strengthened, lead to a more peaceful society. So now we're really bringing in what you would call peace building, or nation building, or state building, or at Princeton we have an institute that calls innovations for successful societies. There are multiple ways you can describe this, but it is the positive work of making life better, not just avoiding what makes life unlivable. And that, to me, again, to try to measure that, and I'm sure those measures will be controversial, and of course, the more complex you get, the more area of disagreement there is. Still, it seems to me to put that in a positive index is a very important step forward. And finally, I wanted to just note a couple of the findings in this report, which I thought were things I would take back to my classes if I were and assigned this document. One is something that doesn't surprise me, but I'm always happy to see it confirmed empirically, which is there is still a big gap between democracies on the one hand and non-democracies and hybrid regimes on the other in terms of peace. Now, the causal arrows can run in multiple directions, right? It is much easier to establish a democracy if you have the conditions for peace. This says a causal statement, but still, it's important in a world in which we are actively debating the value of liberal democracy as a means of making human lives better, to see an index that is this broad with this many countries that says no. You know, the democracies are more peaceful in terms of absence of violence and fear of violence, but also in terms of the positive peace index from either non-democracies or hybrid regimes. And the second point that I thought was very interesting, and I'd love to hear more about, is the tipping. There's a tipping point, that if we can get countries to a certain level, then there's a tipping point after which even small gains in the level of peacefulness is correlated with large gains in the decline of corruption and increases in GDP. And that strikes me as an important finding, an encouraging finding, in the sense that it is not a linear slog, if you want to think about it that way. That you don't, not every increment of development is equally difficult. That there's a very tough period where you are addressing these fundamental sources of violence, weak institutions. But then you get to a point where suddenly relatively small increases lead to much bigger changes. And in terms of thinking about fragile states, again, and obviously this index is very important in terms of looking at fragile states, identifying them, looking at their progress up or down the index. That idea that you can get them to a tipping point seems to me something that we as development practitioners, as people who focus particularly on fragile states should take very seriously. So, again, the idea that there is an index seems to me very, very important, and that it is moving just not just from the fear of violent lack of violence or the fear of violence to a positive peace index is enormously important. And the fact that we have these measures, we can dispute these measures, and we can draw correlations out of them and points out of them that can serve as points of departure for dissertations, for think tank reports, and for our collective work is a true contribution. So I'm delighted to have had the chance to inaugurate this session of the new Global Peace Index. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Slaughter, and I will get the questions to Terry, the answers to your questions. Well, she covered it. I don't feel like I need to say much more. No, I do, and I have a PowerPoint for that. But she covered a lot of what we'll talk about. I want to thank CSIS again, Joy in the back of the room, for all your incredible organizing. Thank you for that. And thank the ambassador. Both the ambassador and Dr. Slaughter had to head off to a board meeting. And thank you, Emily and Larry, for joining us. The panelists at the end, Daniel Hislop is a colleague of mine from Australia. He's the research director for the Institute for Economics and Peace, and will be on hand during the Q&A for any of the gritty data or methodology questions, as well as Leo Bruzzi from Economist Intelligence Unit on hand as well, in case you have any country-specific questions. All right, let's get started. My name is Michael Schenk, and I'm the vice president of the Institute for Economics and Peace. In addition to what you see here and what I've underlined in terms of what we're trying to do, understanding the key drivers and measures of peace and illuminating the economic benefits, another way to talk about that, we try to provide a full accounting of the costs of violence, complementing that with kind of a roadmap for how a country can improve its peace and the economic benefits from those improvements. This is also, it should have been in handouts on your seats and certainly in the report, a little bit of our global support. If you can't see it here, everything from Nobel laureates to secretaries general, prime ministers, and presidents supporting our efforts. We often get the question, how is our index, both our Global Peace Index and our US Peace Index, which we released in April on the Hill, how is it used? And here's a brief example of how it is used by the UN, OECD, World Bank, CIPRI, and others, including the academies increasingly in universities in textbooks and curriculum. This is what I'm going to talk about briefly and then pass it off to Emily and Larry and then hopefully a robust Q&A. So I look forward to your questions. Begin queuing them up now. We'll have roving mics for that. I'm going to cover the 2012 Global Peace Index results. As Dr. Slaughter mentioned, we're in our sixth year now, so we're going to be able to look at some trends, which I'll identify as well. Then there's the whole money question. What does it all mean? We talk about economic benefits. What are they? What's the dollar figure behind that? Lastly, I'll end on the Positive Peace Index, which, as the ambassador mentioned, is new for us this year. So, many ways to define and measure peace. Dr. Slaughter already referenced how we do that. I just want to reiterate it again. On the left, in terms of negative peace or the absence of violence or the absence of fear of violence, is what comprises our Global Peace Index, 23 indicators. I'll refer to them shortly, but you get a sense of what we're looking at. But this year, we're complementing that work with a Positive Peace Index. Again, I feel like I'm repeating Dr. Slaughter. I really appreciate her great introduction. But we're looking at the attitudes, institutions, and structures that, when strengthened, help increase the peace, and thus, per my earlier point, hopefully free up economies to perform better. In terms of how we do it, the Institute for Economic Peace, in concert and coordination with our international independent panel of experts, as well as in coordination with the Economist Intelligence Unit, defining the philosophical approach, the indicators, the scores, the weights, and thanks to the EIU for their incredible work in collating and aggregating that data for us. All right, here we go. The Global Peace Index, 23 indicators, five of which are dedicated solely to ongoing conflicts and the deaths from those conflicts. 10 are dedicated to safety and security in society. So that's everything from violent crime, homicide, incarceration, perceptions of criminality, likelihood of violent demonstration, political instability, some of which are identified here. And the remaining eight have to do with militarization, military expenditures, percentage of GDP, heavy weapons, exports, imports of those weapons, military sophistication, availability of small weapons, and two, Dr. Slaughter's question, I'll address one of them and I'll address the other later, but in terms of peacekeeping, that is under militarization. We actually score that positively. So based on your contribution to UN peacekeeping, you get a better score, the more of the percentage of your committed payments are paid. So that's actually a positive score. All right, so here's the quick overview on the GPI 2012. It's become slightly more peaceful. This is good news based on the last 2 years where we saw a negative trend, a downhill or downward trend. Sub-Saharan Africa for the first time is no longer at the bottom in terms of regional scores. Perhaps unsurprisingly, Middle East and North Africa is now at the bottom. But Sub-Sahara, and I'll get to a PowerPoint slide later that shows where Sub-Saharan Africa actually improved on several indicators. The most marked improvements in peace have to do with the following. So we see less political terror, and the way we define political terror has to do with kind of suppression of political rights, integration, participation in the political process. We saw fewer terrorist acts, and I'll have a slide on that shortly. And then in terms of three measures of militarization where we saw less spending, military expenditure as percentage of GDP, less military sophistication, and fewer heavy weapons. A lot of that is a response to austerity cuts and what that does to budgets, and certainly we're facing that in Washington right now, and that's at the fore of the conversation around defense cuts at the Pentagon. Largest declines in peace, it's very domestic. So we see a rise in perceptions of criminality in society. People are becoming more fearful of the potential for crime. We're seeing a rise in likelihood of violent demonstration. We're seeing a rise in homicide and violent crime as well as organized conflict. A map that's also in your reports, but just gives you a quick overview of very high in peace in blue, low in peace in red, and everything in between. Top 10 most peaceful countries. Okay. I want to identify a couple case studies here that are interesting. So Iceland, number one, for the second year running. Iceland, as you know, in 2008 went through its own financial crisis. It rebounded, and it's actually on the top of the GPI and our positive peace index, which shows that it has the resilience to withstand those kind of shocks to the system. So too with Japan, as you know, with the tsunami and the earthquake, staying here in the top 10, largely because of its resilience, strong on the GPI and strong on the PPI, which I'll get to in a bit. 10 least peaceful countries, perhaps no surprise with many of them at war. However, the good news here with the bottom 10 is that 7 of the 10 improved their scores, which is good. Risers and fallers. We'd like to look at the risers and fallers as well to see what trends and what other countries can learn from kind of the lessons of the risers and fallers. Sri Lanka coming out of a civil war improved its score tremendously on the GPI. Syria, perhaps no surprise, and Dr. Slaughter talked about Syria, the biggest faller. I've already talked briefly about this, but the positive trends, again, less political terror, fewer terrorist acts, less spending on military expenditure as percentage of GDP, capability, and heavy weapons decreased. The negative, perhaps where policymakers want to focus their attention. And then for those of you who are kind of in the conflict field or in the development field, none of this might be new information because we know over the past several years we're seeing a trend away from countries fighting each other to more internal civil war, wars between citizens and civilians against their government. I highlighted two regional trends that are worth noting. Again, I've already talked about Middle East and North Africa dropping, but Asia being the biggest riser for regions. Responsible for that, Sri Lanka, which I've already mentioned coming out of a civil war, certainly the Philippines as well as Burma. Notable US trends. Okay, in case there's confusion, the US GPI score improved in part because its incarceration went down, its terrorist acts went down, actually its weapons exports went up, kind of mitigating for the improvement. But it improved slightly, but its rank in the GPI dropped 6 slots. Why? Essentially because the US was outperformed by other countries. Other countries on the faster track towards peacefulness. The analogy I like to make in terms of motivating improved peacefulness in the U.S. is the ranking in the OECD in terms of U.S. scores on reading, science, and math being outperformed there. So too on the GPI, we're being outperformed. I've already mentioned this, incarceration down, a lot of that happening in California, actually, as it's releasing some of its prisoners, terrorist incidents downs, weapons exports up, the president with various deals that I'm sure you're familiar with. But the indicators that I'd like to draw attention to where the U.S. is in the bottom 25% are the following. So we still have some of the highest incarceration in the world, highest military expenditure as percentage of GDP in the world, heavy weapons, exports, organized conflict, and deaths from those conflicts. Six-year trends. The notable factor here is that 101 countries improved their peace. That's good news. We want to see more of that. We look at 158 countries. Ideally, we'd see 158 countries there. But the fact that it's 101 over 66 from last year, that's good news. That's what we at IEP like to see. Okay, now we're looking at trends, given that we've done the Global Peace Index for 6 years. Next few slides have to do with trends, which might be informative for you. Here are the strongest correlations with GPI indicators and GPI score. Perhaps none of it's surprising. I just want to add to this slide three socioeconomic indicators that have strong correlation with the GPI score: mean years of schooling, infant mortality, and life expectancy. So countries that score high in the GPI, the Global Peace Index, have higher mean years of schooling, higher life expectancy, lower infant mortality. That's also a path forward in terms of roadmap and how to deal with education and health. I've already mentioned this, but the rest of the world reducing their military expenditure as percentage of GDP, the exception being North America, which is kind of plateauing for the moment. Good news on terrorism fatalities, down. Perhaps no surprise here, interesting note that Mexico is almost on par with Libya in terms of deaths from organized conflict. This is what Dr. Slaughter was mentioning, and given our 6 years of data with the Global Peace Index, now we can look at this. And what she was excited about and what we're excited about is that there is a bit of a tipping point as countries improve their peace along the x-axis. There is a bit of a tipping point. You see lowering of corruption pretty precipitously. So too with GDP per capita improvements, higher GDP per capita. In fact, I actually want to go back to that. On average, for every 10 slots a country improves on the GPI, you see an improvement of about $3,100 in GDP per capita. Over a three-year trend, now not six-year, but three-year, the most improved indicator in the GPI was relations with neighbors. Again, those of you deep in the field of development and conflict and foreign policy, we know that we're getting away from warring country to country, and now the war is much more civil, unrest between citizens and their governments. But noticeable here, sub-Saharan Africa, best indicator, Asia, Latin America, performing worse here, Middle East, North Africa, and North America. Okay, so the money question. We claim economic benefits. Let me talk a bit about this. We work with several economists, two of whom I think some of you will know, John Tepper Meilin. He was the chief economist for the Joint Economic Committee, also the chief economist for New York City, as well as Jürgen Brauer, who's coming out with a book that USIP is publishing. I think we have some USIP folks in the house. They're publishing a book of his on peace economics. We work with them to understand the cost of violence. What's the economic impact of violence? Well, there's both a direct cost. I'm going to use a homicide as an example because it's the best example. There's a direct cost associated with that. There's a medical cost. There's a court cost. There's a justice cost, police cost. But then there's a long-term cost, loss of economic productivity, because that person is dead and they're not contributing to the workforce. They're not in labor. So what's the long-term loss in terms of economic productivity from that act of violence? Using those measures and working with John Tepper Meilin, Jürgen Brauer, and several others, $9 trillion is the economic impact of violence on the world GDP. Another way to think of that figure, certainly we talk a lot about the economic impact of the financial crisis to the world GDP. In comparison to violence, violence clearly the overwhelming impact in terms of loss to GDP. In terms of savings, what can we save? Well, we don't assume that we can be a world free of violence. Certainly that would be great. But we talk about manageable, feasible goals, one of which is a 25% reduction in violence. If we can reduce violence by 25%, what would that gain in terms of world GDP. $2.25 trillion. The U.S. share of that, given that the U.S. is about 25% of the world GDP, is $500 billion. Interesting number, given that defense cuts are around $500 billion. Certainly, Congress might be pleased to see potential gains there in the age of our new austerity here. Okay, I want to switch to positive peace index. Over 6 years of understanding the GPI, we identified 8 factors that strongly correlate with more peaceful societies. Those 8 factors: sound business environment, well-functioning government, equitable distribution of resources are the strongest. And then you have a few others, which intuitively make sense: free flow of information, acceptance of the rights of the others, relations with neighbors, low corruption, high education. Iceland, as I mentioned, performing well on the PPI and the GPI. If you have this, you're much more resilient to shocks, be they environmental or economic. U.S., interestingly, does well on many, could improve on a few of these. I'm sure you have your own assessment of where the U.S. could improve, but equitable distribution of resources, given we have the highest income inequality since World War II and the Great Depression, but also in corruption, relations with neighbors, and if you ask Tom Friedman, arguably education, because we're lagging, as I mentioned, with OECD rankings. This is where we get our data behind those 8 factors or 8 pillars. This is also in your report, if you'd like to follow up on it later. A map of the performance on the PPI, and finally, to Dr. Slaughter's point, where she was glad to see the correlation, perhaps unsurprisingly, full democracies are also strong on the PPI and the GPI, whereas as you get up to flawed democracies or more authoritarian regimes, they're performing poorly on the PPI and the GPI. And there we are. I want to, before I turn it over to Emily and Larry, I want to show one thing for reference. I'm not going to kind of interact with this data now, but we have a new map up. This is on, so we have 2 websites. We have Economics and Peace, which is the organizational website. We also have Vision of Humanity, which is an organizational website. This is where we're putting all our maps. We just launched this today. It's very interactive, so you can compare countries. I could compare U.S. to China, look at the scores. So I encourage you to go to visionofhumanity.org, where you'll find that. Thank you, and I'll turn it over to Emily and Larry.
Hi there. I'll go ahead and start, and then
go ahead.
Okay. Just had a few opening remarks. I cover Congress and foreign policy, so I'm looking at this report through the lens of the lawmakers who are trying to influence foreign affairs, and mostly are able to do that through the appropriations process, foreign aid, funding for the State Department, the Pentagon, et cetera. Just a couple of things that stood out to me from that vantage point. The first might sound a bit counterintuitive, but I actually saw some good news out of the data on the Middle East and the declines in their peacefulness, because to me, and granted this is a fairly optimistic vantage point, but there does seem to be a short-term upheaval with the potential for some long-term improvements in their democracy. And as Mike and I think Anne-Marie both mentioned, even flawed democracies are associated with stronger levels of peacefulness, and particularly in the GPI. So if there is, in fact, movement in that direction, I think you could see places like Tunisia, Egypt, Libya, Yemen start to move higher on those rankings, even though they're declining in the short term. And I think that when you talk to folks on the Hill, you do get a sense that they get that. They understand the importance of democracy and trying to entrench democracy. Pro-democracy funding is one of the few areas where there does seem to be agreement on both ends of the party, and that's good news. I think in terms of execution, implementation of those ideals is where they are dropping the ball a little bit. There's not a big plan on the Hill for funding these democracy programs in the Middle East. There's a lot of talk about jobs and economy. You don't hear as much talk right now about how they can promote democracy, entrench some of the gains that have been made out of the Arab Spring, work on the election process, et cetera. And frankly, I don't think the administration has been doing a very good job of that either, at least in their communication with the Hill. You don't hear a lot from them about how they're trying to achieve the gains they are lauding. They've proposed a $770 million program in the Middle East, but with very few details, and that never goes over well with lawmakers who want to have a lot of control and a lot of detail and a lot of metrics about how the money is going to be spent. So I think that's going to be an interesting battle in the coming months and in the appropriations process, how they flesh out this vision for the Middle East, in particular in terms of democracy promotion. The second takeaway for me that I think would have some resonance on the Hill and in the broader foreign policy community here in Washington is the notion that while external conflicts seem to be declining, we're seeing a rise in internal conflicts. I know Dr. Slaughter mentioned this, Mike alluded to it as well. That's bad news because I don't think that the United States is as equipped to deal with those types of conflicts. I think you see them trying to transition from an ideological standpoint and from a practical standpoint, but there's so much debate, there's such a lack of consensus on how to approach this. Syria is obviously a case in point. The successes of Libya are often taken as arguments to intervene in Syria, but I just think there's such a lack of consensus, and I don't think that there are the tools that people are really conceptualizing how to approach these crises with any level of great understanding or expertise, particularly on the Hill. So you're seeing sort of a stopgap approach on each of these conflicts, and I think there could be a lot more attention paid by policymakers on developing better approaches, more emphasis, better tools, better funding mechanisms to address some of these internal conflicts. And again, Syria seems to be demanding a lot of time from lawmakers right now. I don't think there's any consensus on the Hill. You're seeing just a complete, range of polar opposite opinions and debates going on, and I don't really see that dissipating anytime soon. The third takeaway for me was the militarization component as an indicator. I think if you look at the U.S. and their military spending and their arms exports, you would see that the whole idea of militarization as a negative correlation with peace is really something that hasn't sunk in here. I think it's a pretty entrenched, the whole ideology of peace through strength. And I think that might be a hard thing to change lawmakers' minds or policymakers' minds on at this point. So to me, that's a bit of bad news, because I think for the U.S., there's always on the Hill more impetus to spend money on arms, on security. Even on foreign aid, you look at the areas that get the most funding from the Hill, and they're associated with security. It's very easy to make an argument that we need more aid money for Afghanistan, that we need to spend money for foreign military assistance to Israel and Egypt and Jordan. Those tend to find a lot more support in Congress than funding for global health, for conflict prevention, for humanitarian aid even. And so I think that if you're going to try and change the approach to foreign aid, you're going to have to look at that militarization component, but I don't necessarily see that shifting in the near term. So those are the few points that struck me, and I'll turn it over to Colonel Wilkerson.
Okay, thank you.
I'll talk from the same perspective of the points that struck me from this. And the first one I've got to say something about before I get to the three I really want to talk about is that if you are the world's policeman, and regardless of what we might think, whether we're independents, Democrats, or Republicans, that is indeed what we decided to be in 1947, with some judicious and some injudicious selection of where we would police and what crimes we would go after, you have a different approach to the world with regard to militarization. As the people who set this all up in 1947 fought and argued about, that's a threat to your own republic too, especially if your own republic was founded on the principle of small standing army, if any army at all, and non-interference in others' affairs. In 1947, we decided to interfere in the global community on a regular basis. And we built the armed forces, including a massive nuclear complex, in order to do that in the shadow of another antagonistic entity called the Soviet Union. And we now have the detritus of that. And frankly, since 1991, we haven't figured out what to do with that detritus. We have been at war more since the end of the Cold War than we were arguably in the Cold War, with less positive results And with the kinds of things that we've pointed out here with regard to militarization continuing apace and apparently no desire to do anything about it. Whether we should do something about it in a significant way is a big question, though, because the world's still a very dangerous place. You can argue that we've been injudicious in our policing on occasion. I would argue Iraq was a colossal case in point. But nonetheless, it's still a very dangerous place. So militarization will continue to be an aspect of the world's policeman. It has to be, I think. The question is how well you use that police force and what purposes you put it afield for. The three points that struck me, first of all, I was a participant in Vienna a couple of years ago of an American Bar Association / World Justice Project conference on the rule of law, and we were building and had built pretty much to that point, and we're fine-tuning a rule of law index. And I was one of the few non-lawyers there. Will Taff, who was Powell's legal advisor, former Deputy Secretary of Defense, and is a lawyer himself, was sort of my colleague through it, so he would kind of whisper at me every now and then when I wouldn't understand the arcane law terminology. But one of the things I found in that three-day conference, listening to the Chinese, listening to the Indonesians, listening to almost all the Europeans, we had 400 different lawyers, if you will, there from all over the world, was how important, how absolutely basic to nonviolence or to controlling violence, to peace, the rule of law is. And yet, except for the two categories in here, perhaps functioning government or non-functioning government, corruption or non-corruption or low levels of corruption, the rule of law doesn't seem to be that present, except by implication. So that was my first takeaway from it, was that the rule of law really probably should play more integrally in this, and not just in, maybe it ought to be its own category. They certainly convinced me in Vienna that it was significant. And when I saw how many different interpretations of the law there were, coming from all across the globe, and how vigorously these lawyers, mostly, some judges and others, but they were lawyers once too in most cases, defended their particular culture and its aspect of the law. And you had such things as stoning women for adultery on the one extreme, and on the other extreme, China hanging people for essentially, or killing people, capital offenses, that even in this country, where we continue to have the death penalty, we wouldn't condone. So, I mean, it was a wide range of rule of law interpretations. And yet, I think we made some progress. In fact, I think we made some significant progress. The second point that I took away from it comes from something I was doing recently and had to back away from because it simply just got too busy. But Leon Firth and a group over at the National Defense University are working on something, and Anne Marie was a part of this, called the actionable foresight. It sounds like strategic thinking. It is. But it's more than that. It's trying to give the United States government a means to be other than tactical. And if you've ever served in the government, you know what I mean. Whether you're in the Pentagon, where there's a little bit of strategic thinking that goes on, but usually Washington obviates that, or whether you're at the State Department, where there's almost none going on, or any other place in the government, everybody handles the crisis du jour. That's it. You don't have time for anything else. So what Leon and his very astute group of people were trying to do, Leon having been Al Gore's national security advisor and certainly knowing how dysfunctional the U.S. government has become, was to build an apparatus within the government, institutionalize it, that would at least make people have to start thinking about things out there and actually formulating policy that might go into effect sometime into the future or might go into effect partially after they formulate it in order to shape the future and head off things rather than react to things, which is basically what we've been doing, particularly since the end of the Cold War. This would be a marvelous tool for that. It would be a marvelous tool for that. Where is the most likely Iraq or Afghanistan or whatever to appear? And some of it's surprising. It's not necessarily where you might think. Colin Powell once said, "I never managed a crisis I expected." Well, that says a number of things about the way the government works, but it also says something about the way life works. You usually don't see the crisis coming in until it's upon you. This would be a marvelous tool to help you see crises coming a little bit better and to deal with them perhaps so they didn't become a crisis. The third point that I take away from it is one my wife sort of screamed at me at 4 a.m. this morning when she was looking over my shoulder, and she said, "Boy, this really condemns the United States, doesn't it?" And I said, "What do you mean?" And she said, "Well, I mean, we don't do peace building very well, and we're a very unpeaceable nation." And, you know, regardless of our status in there, she's got a point. This is a good tool for looking at ourselves, too. And where would you take that? Well, I would take that to the point that the report is supposed to take it to, as far as I'm concerned. That is that we need a lot of work in this country, too, both on our own internal democracy, as it were. Anne Marie and I were talking about that this morning. We're more plutocracy now than we are democracy. And secondarily, we need to be very circumspect about what we think we can do in these countries and the money we spend on doing it and the people we support in doing it. I would offer a rule, for example, as a 31-year serving infantry officer, the country or countries that fight the war should never be the people who build the peace. So what do? You turn to the UN? Well, that's one avenue. You turn to another coalition? Well, that's another avenue. The Canadians and others are a lot better at doing that sort of thing than we are. So how would you make that transition? How would you do that? If we're the police force that knocks down the dictator, who's the force that comes in afterwards, or the institution or institutions that come in afterwards and do the peace building? Because it's damn sure that we aren't any good at it. We've proven that. For 50 years now, we've proven that. We can't even handle our own money in the field. The corruption in the field is unbelievable. Veterans of Afghanistan and Iraq come back and tell me horror stories, and I can tell them horror stories from Vietnam, my war. So if we don't do it very well, why do we keep doing it? So you've got two choices, you know, three choices. You can continue doing it and be insane, or you can let someone else do it after you've done the dirty hard work, or you can learn to do it. Any one of those alternatives is open, I think, but it's clear that we need to take one of them. Those are my takeaways.
Great. Thank you, Colonel Wilkinson. And thank you, Emily. I want to respond to a few of the comments that came up and then get into a Q&A with the audience so we can have a robust conversation here. I would just like to second what they've already reiterated in terms of a tool for assessing risk and resilience, which I talked about in the PowerPoint, but also a tool for monitoring and evaluating the effectiveness of foreign aid and development projects and U.S. interventions. So both particularly the Positive Peace Index, useful tool there in M&E, but both indices good for assessing risk and resilience. To Dr. Slaughter's question about violence against women, certainly as data gets stronger and better for all 158 countries that we're assessing, we will begin incorporating that. Currently the data, and I can default to Daniel here in a second because I want to ask his question on the rule of law per Colonel Wilkinson's comment. Currently, the data is strong around 50 countries, but not all 158. As that data gets is more available and accessible and credible, we'll certainly be integrating that into our index. In terms of rule of law, Daniel, do you want to address his comment about rule of law?
Yeah, sure. I mean, if you look at the Positive Peace Index, rule of law is one of the factors that we've included as being very important for positive peace building. So you can see on page 72 of the report, there's a list of the indicators there, and it's included there. In terms of the gender issue, that domestic violence is certainly a very important form of violence that needs to be measured. And there's at least two technical issues. So in index design, what we want to see is a minimization of the amount of collinear factors. Domestic violence tends to be collinear with forms of violent crime, homicide, which are actually included in the index. So in some sense, we do account for the latent variable of domestic violence. I think that, and I was having this discussion with Leo from the EIU earlier, that there certainly are more data sources that are coming out. And I think that this is something the expert panel is constantly looking at the issue of potentially including domestic violence indicators with new data.
And just as a case in point that was shocking for those of us at IEP, if you look at the U.S. Peace Index, which is available on our website, which we released in April on the Hill, just comparing the unfortunate high incidences of rape in the U.S. to Canada. Imagine the chart that I had about the global financial crisis and the cost to the GDP versus violence and that economic impact of violence to the GDP, global GDP. Same differential in terms of rapes in the U.S. versus rapes in Canada. So we definitely account for that in our violent crime. Would like to open it up for question and answer. I believe Anne is circulating with microphones. Yeah, Pia, and then we'll come over onto this side. Just want to stand up and identify yourself. Think, who's got you've got the microphones back there. Yeah, Pia, can you stand up? You had your hand up first. And then we'll go over there and then I'll come to you. If you can wait for the microphone.
Hi, sorry, I'm Pia Bungarten from the German Friedrich Ebert Foundation. Colonel Wilkerson, the Germans have very good memories of the American peace building democracy support, so there are some positive examples as well. My question is, I completely agree with you that picking up on crisis in the crisis science is very important. So my question is, in doing the peace index, are you picking up on signals of stress from Europe, you know, from the financial crisis, especially for the southern European countries? And that's very much economic and financial, and it is spilling over into political unrest already too. Thanks.
Without question, Pia, thank you for that question. Greece, as an example, fell 40 slots in the Global Peace Index. So without question, we are already starting to see that slippage and will likely continue to see it in future years of the Global Peace Index.
Well, let me just make... if you want to use force to completely reduce a country, which I think is almost impossible these days, then the United States can build something. But we don't seem to be able to build anything in situ. We don't seem to be able to build anything while we're actually trying to do the taking down, or immediately after the taking down, without having absolutely brought the country to prostration, which is where Germany and Japan really were. So I stick to my argument that we don't do this very well.
There was a hand fourth row back over on the, yes, the woman. Sorry, you had your hand up. I want to get you before we move on.
Hi, my name is Jessica Worth. I'm a summer associate at the Public International Law and Policy Group. My question is about incarceration and how you might account for countries like Egypt and Tunisia that are really in transitional justice right now. And transitional justice, people want accountability. They want former members of the regime to be brought to justice. They want people who took advantage of instability to be held accountable for, you know, what they did in society. Yet on the other end, over-incarceration is clearly a sign of authoritarianism and absence of the rule of law, which is a big problem. So I was wondering how in the metrics you broke that out, because just pure incarceration probably doesn't account enough for differences across societies. Thanks.
Thank you for that question. And you're identifying a difficulty in any index aggregation in terms of quality of data and how countries are reporting that data. I'm going to actually turn that over to our research director. Daniel, do you want to attend to that?
Yeah, it's an interesting question. The data source that we use is a source called the World Prison Population List. The U.S. has the highest incarceration in that list, highest rate per 100,000. And in terms of the banding, because the U.S. is so far ahead of many other countries, it tends to mean that the U.S. is the only one that scores a 5 out of 5, and then you have this sort of fairly big fall off for the rest of the world. So there is this other issue, of course, where you have countries like Somalia, which have very few civil institutions and, as a result, very low incarceration. So it works. There are some problems, I guess, in terms of trying to account for the figure.
Thank you. This gentleman in the front row.
if you can wait for the microphone. Thanks, Mark.
Mark Schneider, International Crisis Group. I sort of have a positive and a negative. Positive seems to me that the index does underscore some knowledge that we have. If you go back to the Carnegie Commission on Preventing Deadly Violence, the World Development Report on Conflict Development from last year, we know a lot about these issues. And I think the index helps us to see how we go forward. The problem is, if you look at what the Congress has done, and if you look at what the various development agencies have done, it seems to me that it's very difficult to see major shifts in the way that they've been dealing with the issues of long-term state building or long-term development processes. And part of the problem is it is long-term, and it's very hard to get us to focus in that way. The World Development Report said the change is, it's a 20-year change. Well, to build institutions, that makes sense. But to have Congress vote appropriations and say, okay, here's a program, we're going to provide the funding on a 20-year basis, it's very hard to see that happening. I'd be interested in comments about how do you make it happen. Because I think we do know a lot about what will help countries move from fragility to sustainable development. But we haven't really figured out how we change the way we're operating in order to help them get there.
There is the conundrum, Mark. Thank you for that question. And I think Emily testified to the lack of fertile ground in Congress on these fronts, and Colonel Wilkerson testified to the crisis du jour, both of which pose problems in terms of convincing policymakers to think 20 years out. What we're thinking about with our positive peace index, and then I'll pass it off perhaps to Emily and the Colonel to see if they have thoughts too, given that they're enmeshed in this, is, and we've already got it, but thinking more tangibly, some scorecards on the positive peace index to provide countries with a quick read on where they can improve their resilience. And again, some of our top performing countries in both the PPI and the GPI show that if you work on these eight factors, these eight pillars, you do improve your resilience. And it does help with immunity to risk and shock. So always thinking about truncating the lessons learned from this data in usable format. But in terms of making Congress do anything, that there is the question. I'll turn it over to Emily and Larry if they have any thoughts.
Well, I would just share some of your frustration. I think especially when you look at places like Afghanistan and Pakistan some lawmakers with foresight have tried to do some long-term planning and long-term development programs. You look at the Kerry Lugar Berman program in Pakistan. That was very much an attempt over the long term to focus not just on our military components and military aid, but really focus on civilian aid and building up the economy. That's run into a lot of problems, and I think part of it is the conceptualization was long term, but the political calendar is always short term. People want to see results on a 6-month to year long basis before they'll commit more funds. And that's very challenging when you do development. I think a lot of development workers I hear coming back from Pakistan or Afghanistan are tearing out their hair because there's just pressure to get money out the door and show that money is being spent without much emphasis on how that's impacting the long-term development programs. The good news, and I think there is a little bit of good news, I think at USAID, Raj Shah has really recognized that and is trying to make some really significant changes. And he is popular on the Hill. Lawmakers really like him and really have a lot of faith in what he's doing. And that's both sides of the aisle. So I think that's good news. If you can get people in leadership posts in government who have good relationships with members of Congress and convince them to take their control, release a little bit of control on the levers of the funding and put a little bit of trust in some of these administrators, that could make a difference. The other thing I've noticed, there's been a lot of emphasis on Republicans, austerity, attempting to cut foreign aid. I actually see in the Senate a lot of Republicans who have been strongly supportive of foreign aid. And I think that's one of the big reasons why you saw a smaller reduction than a lot of people expected in the last fiscal year in appropriations. And I think if aid advocates and people advocating for long-term aid can develop those types of coalitions, not just with the Democrats, who are the traditional constituency for foreign aid, but really work with Republicans, lay the groundwork with people like Lindsey Graham, some of these other senior Republicans, on the House side too, Kay Granger, they're open to development concepts. I think they, some of them are not as informed, and they need to have what people euphemistically call the education about foreign aid and its importance. But I do think that you can lay the groundwork with a really good communications process and just open lines of communication with appropriators and members. And I think you're starting to see a little bit of that come to fruition in the budgeting process.
One of the things that Leon addresses in his report, what Emily just reiterated or talked about, is that if you do this in the executive branch, that is to say you succeed in getting actionable foresight processes set up within the cabinet, and particularly oriented around the deputies committee and the principals committee. If you can get this to happen, you're still stuck with the appropriations process. You're still stuck with all these fiefdoms over in the Congress that, for example, Secretary Powell tried to reduce simply from 8 to 4 for state and struck out completely because the subcommittee chairman, who have nothing to do with foreign relations but everything to do with state commerce, justice, operations, and maintenance, wanted to ask foreign relations questions, so weren't about to give up their committee chairmanship. And so Leon's suggestion is that the executive branch do this, make it so tantalizingly successful that the appropriations process will have to realign itself in some way, at least, or at least the existing process, as Emily was intimating, when it's presented with something that looks cogent, sane, and sober, and maybe workable, will give the money, and give the money on a repeated basis, year after year, or whatever time frame is contemplated. It doesn't work to give $18.6 billion to Jerry Brimmer, $9 billion residual in the UN Oil for Food program, and a year later not know where any of it went. And I don't blame the Congress for not wanting to hand it out anymore in that regard. The executive branch simply had nothing together with regard to those monies. A lot of them were stolen. A lot of them are now equipping the Iraqi political process, and that may be a positive in the long run. I don't know. But it's certainly not the way to do business.
Next question. Yes, gentlemen. Mike coming to your right. There you go.
I'm Dr. Bill Durson, also from Sacramento, and with Physicians for Social Responsibility, but not necessarily speaking on behalf. First of all, I'd like to thank you for this effort to basically quantify peacefulness and quantify the economic benefits of peacefulness worldwide in our country. I want to point out, though, how the weighting how the qualitative decisions on the weighting and also in your formula affect this. Dr. Wilkerson mentioned that his wife thought, well, this report's pretty critical of the United States. I think it could be said it's overly, not critical enough. It doesn't bring out the fact the United States spends as much on its military as the next 10 leading militarized countries of the world combined. Virtually half of world military expenditures are spent by the United States. And for example, when you express military expenditures as a percentage of GDP, I'd ask, number one, are you accounting for not only government military expenditures, but also private companies making money off of selling military goods? And also, in the GDP, are you including military, the extent to which military expenditures contribute to the GDP? And if you are, then you've got military expenditures both in the numerator and the denominator tending to minimize how much a country is spending on military expenditures.
Thank you, Bill, for your question. And in terms of weights, I mentioned in the independent process, we're always in conversation with our international independent panel of experts as well as the Economist Intelligence Unit in terms of weighting and scoring the indicators. I will pass this off because your specificity, I think Daniel will be able to answer. It's our research director. Daniel, do you want to have?
Thanks for that. Military expenditure has a fairly low weighting in the index. It's a 2 out of a potential 5, so that's pretty much the lowest weighting possible. The U.S. is in the bottom 25% for military expenditure. In terms of how we get that figure, it's mostly from World Bank data, but also collated by the Economist Intelligence Unit. I guess the important thing is to point out that it is percentage of GDP. It's not the total figure, so The U.S. obviously has a very huge GDP, so the actual final percentage doesn't come across as that large. There are other ways to account for military expenditure, especially in the U.S. case. In that figure, it's only including Department of Defense. It's not including Veterans Affairs, Homeland Security, and other CIA, national security budgets. So the figure could potentially be bigger, but we use the World Bank and Economist Intelligence Unit figure. I don't know if that fully answers the question, but
I would just say that we finished a pretty exhaustive study over at IPS recently. I don't know where you saw it or not, but the real expenditure that we came up with, counting intelligence, counting Homeland Security, counting the Energy Department, the nuclear program, and so forth, was $1.2 trillion. So that's a little bit larger than DOD likes to put out. They like to put out somewhere between 3 and 5% of GDP. We actually spend about 10% of GDP. And when you throw in private contractors, which we didn't do, but we're looking at this year, when you throw in other things like private contractors, security contractors, when you throw in Lockheed Martin, Raytheon, and so forth and so on, it comes up to more like somewhere in the neighborhood of $2 to $3 trillion. That begins to be a serious portion of your GDP. And when you take your other point, which is well made, that you're doing it in the numerator and the denominator in, it's very difficult to do that and to figure out what you're doing to yourself. But I think we're going to come out with at least a section of our report this year that's going to try to assess what we're doing to ourselves, and it ain't good.
Excellent. Thank you. Do you want to follow?
Sorry, up? just one other thing I'd add is weapons exports is also included. So this year that was an indicator for the U.S. and actually went down because exports went up. So, it is in some way accounted as well.
Great. Thank you both. Another question from maybe this side of the room. Yes. The woman in the fourth row there. Yep.
Hello. I'm Dr. Patricia Murphy from International Philosophers for Peace. I believe I should address my question to Daniel. I remember during last year's meeting for the unveiling of the Global Peace Index, there was an important distinction that was made regarding education. And that distinction was that as a driver of peace, the educational level up until basic education, until grade 12, was a significant driver, but that higher education was found not to be a significant driver. And I was wondering if there was any similar finding this year during the study.
Sure, thanks. Education is an important correlate of peace. So it's mean years of schooling that we find as being the really strong factor, not the percentage of GDP spent on the education system, which is kind of perverse in some way. The positive peace index includes two measures of education, which you can see, one of which is mean years of schooling. So that we see is a fairly important factor in terms of determining or shaping a peaceful environment.
And I'll just add to that before we go to the next question. In our U.S. Peace Index, it's a much stronger correlation with particularly secondary enrollment and high school graduation rates. When we go global, that particular correlation is not quite as strong. What is stronger is mean years of schooling. But in the U.S. Peace Index in particular, secondary, not tertiary, is the strongest correlation. Thank you for your question. Check. We've got a question here in the front row. Yeah.
Thank you, Chick Dombach, Chief of Staff for Congressman John Garamendi, and I'll confess I'm on the Board of Directors of the Institute for Economics and Peace. Given the congressional role, and a lot of the comments have been related to where Congress is and where Congress might be, if we were to organize a briefing for members of Congress coming out of the Global Peace Index, what would you see as the central message that you would want to convey to the Congress that would have a meaningful impact on policy development within the Congress? I know that's a huge question, but it's the central question, certainly from my perspective. Thank you.
Indeed, and Chick, I appreciate you asking that question. Let me just turn my microphone on. Well, we're not IEP is not necessarily in the business of policy prescription, but predicated on our work, particularly with the positive peace index, where could Congress or any policymaker from any country or at the state or the city level, in reference to our U.S. peace index, which looked at states and cities within America, rank them, that is the roadmap. The positive peace index is the roadmap for improved peacefulness and for the economic benefits that are freed up when you improve your peace. So if I was policymaker X in country X or here in Congress, I would take a look at that, and particularly for America, like I already mentioned in the PowerPoint, where could America improve? And certainly, I think on sound business environment, generally speaking, well-functioning government, as long as partisan bickering doesn't get in the way, free flow of information, in terms of education, all of those fairly good. Clearly improvements could be made, but where I as a policymaker would think most about the improvements, it would be around the equitable distribution of resources, lowering corruption, and improving relations with neighbors. That's based solely on our data and where the improvements need to be made. So I think in terms of a roadmap and a tool guide for policymakers, it's in the data, it's in the positive peace index, not only improving your peace, but seeing the economic benefits from it. Thanks for your question. Unless any of you, Larry, did you? Okay. In the very, very back, white shirt. And then the woman right in front of him afterwards. Thanks.
My name is Jessica Noonan. I'm here with the Oxbridge Academy. I would have a question for the Colonel. Do you think that the U.S. military-industrial complex has a significant effect on the poor peace-building record as they would gain economic benefits from the continuing conflicts?
Smedley Butler, a Marine two-star general, once testified to the Congress of the United States that he never made one of his 29 deployments, most of which were in Latin America, a couple in Asia, that weren't for capitalism. And he didn't mean that favorably. There's a certain aspect to that. It's much easier, for example, to go to war when you know that Lockheed Martin share price is going to go from $26 on March the 18th, 2003, to $126 on March the 18th, 2004. A lot of people make a lot of money, a lot of jobs, and so forth. I'd be utterly lying if I said the military-industrial congressional complex doesn't have an impact on national security decision-making, indeed on foreign policy writ large. It certainly does. The question is it still part of that judicious, only country in the world with the capacity to do so, leadership role, or is it morphing into something quite less? And that's for the American people to say. And so far they've been really quiet about this, choosing to turn to patriotism and clapping at the Atlanta airport when Afghan and Iraqi veterans come home, assuaging their own guilt because less than 1% of 311 million people is bleeding and dying for the other 310 million. That's what it's all about, really. We don't have anything but a socioeconomically determined enlisted force right now. My son and I talked about it. My son's in the Air Force. We talked about this weekend. It's becoming glaringly so. And the officer corps has some problems with that, as you might well imagine, because it does not represent America anymore. No matter how much we may clap for it, and we may cheer it, and we may feel good when we put the flag up and have Memorial Day, it does not represent America anymore. So yes, the answer to your question is it has an impact.
Thank you, Larry, for that answer. The woman in front of the gentleman, you had your hand up, yes.
Hi, my name is Emily David, and I'm a research associate with Citizens for Global Solutions, now known as globalsolutions.org. And at globalsolutions.org, we seek to provide a membership base for Americans who wish to see the U.S. take a more cooperative and responsible role in the world. From that perspective, a prominent question that was asked today explored how peace metrics can inform U.S. foreign policy. Yet a case can be made that certain messages which capture lawmakers' attention may not be so convincing to the general American citizen who is more concerned with domestic issues such as the large income inequality gap or our growing national debt. So I just wanted to say that we at globalsolutions.org agree with the message expressed here today and would just like to share and spread these ideas further amongst the American public. So my question is, what key message would you impart to U.S. citizens for reasons to support global peacekeeping?
Great question, and I appreciate your affirmation, the organizational support. We'll be sure to put it on our website, that endorsement. The great thing about the Global Peace Index and the Positive Peace Index is that there's something in there for everyone. If you only care about your local community, I live in Anacostia. If I only cared about Anacostia, there'd be something in there for me in terms of domestic data, violent crime, homicide, someone getting shot in front of my house. If I cared only about foreign policy, to the point I mentioned earlier, these are tools for assessing state resilience and its ability to withstand risk and shocks to the system, be it environmental or economic. So what I like about this work is that there's something in it for everyone working at any level of society. In terms of why, well, there's money to be made in improved peacefulness, so that's good. But we're also killing less, hopefully, if we improve the peace, and we're enjoying life more. The point about increase in perceptions of criminality, more fear, that's not a society we want to live in. So how do we improve the world around us so we enjoy our lives and so people are being killed less? So, but to your first point, yeah, I think there's something in it for everyone. Another question. Yes, the one with the purple scarf. Forgive me how I'm identifying folks, but it's...
I'm Annie. I also work with Congressman John Garamendi. We're a bunch of ringers here. I had two quick questions. One is about the decision to not include export of small arms and light weapons in the index, considering the degree to which those weapons are responsible for major deaths around the world. And then the second is about how you count external conflict deaths. So, for example, if the U.S. drops bombs on Iraq that kill 500,000 people, does our peace index go down or does theirs? And then finally, I just wanted to underscore the GDP as a percentage, or as military expenditures as a percentage of GDP, the political context of that. As you know, on the Hill, there are many defense hawks who really like 3%. So I would just be aware, and there's a logic gap. If we get richer, we allegedly get more peaceful, even if our military expenditures stay the same. So that seems problematic. Thanks.
That was a question on small arms, and yeah, no, we don't count exports of small arms. We only count exports of major conventional weapons. The issue with small arms is, I guess, we try and account for that in our small arms availability indicator. So that's a qualitative assessment by the EIU on legislation in countries related to gun control, availability of guns on the black market. And that's a qualitative assessment. In terms of the question of, you know, when the U.S. bombs Iraq and where the deaths get counted, there is a battle death indicator. So if there's U.S. troops that get killed in a foreign operation, then that would be counted on the U.S. side. If there's deaths in Iraq, then those deaths in Iraq get counted in Iraq, so Iraq becomes less peaceful. basically.
So just to clarify then, ignorance, you're using I-casualty numbers.
Yeah.
So if we were to rely more heavily on air power, which saves U.S. lives but tends to have much more, create much far higher levels of civilian deaths, for example, in the country, then that would be, then that country's peace index would go down.
Essentially.
Well,
that's not totally true. So the U.S. would, if that were to happen, then the number of external conflicts would go up. So that's an incident count. So,
okay, in the same external conflict.
Yeah.
You switch your tactics.
That would be correct in the current methodology. Yes.
David Grant, I'm representing Nonviolent Peace Force. Obviously, the unarmed interventions that are successful, a much better way of handling violence. So Sudan has not been mentioned, and I wondered what the consequence of the South Sudan independence was on that figure. And I wondered about how does the United States get credit for the money that has been invested, for instance, in the transition in Sudan. How does that figure into the score?
Yeah, I'll answer and then pass off to answer part of your question and pass it off to Daniel. In terms of our quantitative data, it's primarily from 2011. Our qualitative data, 8 indicators of the 23 are qualitative. We can source up until March 2012. So we might see some of the South Sudan conflict be more reflected in next year's Global Peace Index, just because of how we're able to get available data. But in terms of getting credit, Daniel, do you want to address his point?
Yeah.
In terms of assistance? Is that was your question? Yeah.
In the GPI, so you have to go to the conceptual foundations of the index, which is to measure absence of violence, fear of violence. There is no credit for the U.S. in doing that. In terms of South Sudan, it was independent midway through the measurement period. So you can see on the map, it's a gray space. We don't have any data on it as of yet. But Sudan's score did go down as a result of that. Some of the conflict that's occurred since South Sudan's independence.
I'd like to thank CSIS again, Joy, the ambassador, and Dr. Slaughter, who left, for their participation. I'd like to thank Colonel Wilkerson and Emily Cadet for their participation on the panel. Thank Daniel for his participation, EIU as well. Thank you, everyone, for coming. Appreciate your time.